It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn bustos into robustos. Brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker. And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tehan.
Hey, so the first thing I want to mention is that we brought over Cash Plays over from Poker World. And Barry Greenstein owns that site. So he was gracious enough to let us use the same name. Jeremiah Smith and I used to host it, and Jeremiah's really no longer involved with poker. So I want to give a big prop and thanks to Barry Greenstein for letting us retain the Cash Plays title to our show. So thanks again, Barry.
Yeah, cool and, guys. Barry's one of the coolest guys in poker, too. I mean, he's been around forever and a real stand-up guy. I really like Barry. So,
oh yeah, that's
thanks
right.
Thanks again for letting us use it.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know Barry personally. He just sent me a text saying, "Hey, he is gracious enough to let us keep the title." But you know him personally, and you've always said nice things about him. Yeah. So, not only is he a great player, but I hear he's a great person as well. And this just kind of reinforced that. So, and the second thing I want to mention is that we have a promo code, QuadJacks82, for anyone that wants to get some free coaching or a free 3-day trial at our training site Joe and I run at StackEmCoaching.com. So it's promo code QuadJacks82, number 82. And also, if anyone has any poker questions or hand history questions, you can email it to john@stackemcoaching.com. And Joe and I might just bring it up on air and we'll answer it live. So we've done that before in our previous Cash Plays podcast where Jeremiah would select some hand histories or email questions and we'd answer it on air. So, So any new news on your front, Joe? I just came back from Rincon.
Yeah,
right?
I took a quick little trip down to San Diego to play the Harrah's Rincon tournament. And there was like a 1K down there and a 1500, and then I just drove back up after like 2 days. No luck for me in those tournaments, but it was a fun little trip down there.
What happened? You're one of the top 10 stacks going into day two.
Oh man, yeah, like. The 1K, I finished like 4 or 5 out of the money, and then I played the main event. I had a great day one, and day two, I just lost a bunch of average size pots. I mean, sometimes, you know, like, I had a lot of spots where I had, like, Queen Jack against Ace 8, and, like, things like that were kind of flipping, and when you're losing those, you're just kind of, like, losing chips, and when you're winning those, you're picking up chips that, you know, people think they're owning other players, but it's like, yeah, you're just winning a lot of like flips here and there. I lost a few of those in the middle of day two, and
you know how big your stack never safe in a tournament.
What's that?
Just because 2 hours later, I said, no matter how big your stack is, you're never safe in a tournament. You can have the biggest chip leader. What happened to Luke, your friend that was chip leader going into day two? Did he make it in the money?
No, he didn't even make the money. I mean,
this is what I'm talking about.
But yeah, those things happen though. It's like I hear some people like, oh, well, that's the way he plays, and he can build it up, but he can lose it like just as fast. And like, really, I mean, that's kind of describes a lot of poker players. I mean, some guys are just going to totally knit it up, but for the most part, you know, if you're playing good enough / crazy enough or whatever it is to get to acquire those chips, you're probably going to be in spots to lose them too, I'm sure.
Yeah, what do you think, just a quick tournament question, what do you think is a more profitable style? To play like that, reckless abandonment, accumulate a lot of chips, but you can be out early, or play like a very nitty conservative type? Basically playing like an Alan Kessler type or playing like a Joe Tehan type, which would you rather prefer?
I mean, you know, I think all the best players are very, very tough to play against because they're so aggressive. And I think, you know, the good players that are aggressive, they're doing, you know, they're using controlled aggression. It's not like they totally get out of line all the time. It's like those guys are using aggression, but they're playing pots because they feel comfortable playing in like post flop situations. So I think the aggressive guys are always the toughest to play against.
So you rather stick someone like you or Faraz Jaka over someone like Chainstaw that cashes 50% of his tournaments but never wins one?
Yeah, and he's not cashing like that either rate. But
he does have a pretty cash rate, we have to admit. What, 20, 25%?
Yeah.
Maybe not high, 15, 20%.
Yeah, I mean, I know he plays a lot, and I know he does pretty well, but, you know, and I'm sure Chainsaw's got some moves up his sleeve, too. Like, we don't want to just totally discount that. But
really? Last move was back in 2004, so...
Chainsaw. Yeah, I mean, I played a bit with Chainsaw. You know, he plays a little bit off his image, I think. I haven't played with him a ton, but, you know,
I'm not knocking him. I mean, I'm sure he's capable of some things. So, yeah. And I'm sure he realizes the image that he never plays a hand and does play a hand from time to time. So,
yeah, exactly.
But one other thing regarding that day when you busted out, we had a big bet on Baylor. We're in a survivor pool, and we had to take Baylor. Joe and I went halves. You did an overs pool, and I did the normal pool. And you busted out on the overs pool on day two by taking Duke like an idiot.
I don't even want to get into it.
So I actually made it down to the final four players out of 66 players, and I was forced to go with Baylor, just how circumstances ended up. So we had to sweat Baylor on the same day you busted out of the tournament. And that didn't end too well, so Baylor got crushed by Kentucky. So
yeah, this is a cool little thing we have. It's a winner-take-all survivor pool in the NCAA tournament. And each day you have to pick a winning team. And once you use a team once, they're done. You can't use them anymore for the tournament. So we used like all our big dogs pretty much. We had some guys left. We had Kansas left. But yeah, we had to gamble on Baylor against Kentucky. Yeah. Man, that was ugly.
Yeah, that sucks. But, oh, well, that's how it goes. Another thing is one of our coaches on our site is moving to Mexico to grind online poker. I know there's been people that have done that. I've actually pondered the move myself just because my background is mostly online poker. Going up to Canada, though, to Vancouver, where a lot of online pros reside now. But unfortunately, since I have a family, I can't make that trek. It's not as easy for me as it is most online grinders who are single and can just move on a whim. So, and I live in Vegas, so I have the alternative of playing live cash games, which is pretty cool.
So yeah, I do get pretty jealous. I gotta say, I mean, I get so jealous of those guys. Like when they're like, "Yeah, I'm moving to Costa Rica or wherever it is, Belize and Mexico and all over the place." Like Canada doesn't really sound all that appealing, but I mean, I would probably move to like the Bahamas or somewhere and just play online if I didn't have a wife.
Dude,
and
you had that opportunity.
Away.
Yeah, you had that opportunity until you decided to get married last year. So what were you thinking, dude? Didn't you learn from me? Yeah, learn from me, man. I'm trying to set an example or learn from my mistakes. I'm just kidding. You know, living in Vegas definitely has its perks. So we can play live anywhere, anytime. So you know that. I used to live in Vegas.
8 years.
Yeah. I know you haven't been following this deal or this news, the FTP Tapie deal, the full tilt saga that's going on. I haven't heard about it too much recently, but I know last week there was some news that it was going to get done. Tapie's brother or son moved to Ireland where the former headquarters of Full Tilt Poker was, so they're saying a deal's imminent. I've always been pessimistic about the situation, and I actually have a lot of money tied up on Full Tilt because that's where I grinded almost all my cash games, but I've never been optimistic about it. It's just been one headache after another and one bad news after another. So I don't. My personal opinion is I'm not going to expect anything until some like real news, something that's actually has substance comes out. And I'm sure a lot of people out there have money on Full Tilt. And I mean, some of the numbers that are on Full Tilt, we can go over this, but I'm not going to name names, but I know guys, and you know them too, Joe, guys that have four or 500,000. One guy has 1.2 million on. And this is this is already new, so I'll say Jungle Man had the most of like 4 or 5 million, I think, and he ended up selling his at 80 cents on the dollar. If that's confirmed true, that was already news out. So what were you saying, Joe?
No, I knew of just a lot of people that just got screwed out of a lot of money. I mean, I know Jungle Man was the biggest one the biggest one I heard, anyways.
Yeah, but he actually, I think he sold his stake, and I wish I had sold ours. Instead, remember, Joe, we ended up buying a couple
of people's. You talked me into this. I was.
I mean, that's
not very happy about this.
This is like within a month after Black Friday, and people are selling, 80 cents on the dollar, 90 cents?
Yeah,
we just thought it was a good deal.
And like, oh my gosh, this Full Tilt money is never going to go away. This is like solid gold. Let's buy my friends for, what is it, 80 cents on the dollar?
I think it was 80 cents on the dollar.
It's probably
so,
90 or something, knowing you.
I think it's worth 8 cents on the dollar now. lock it up.
A month after Black Friday. I mean, I don't know why we're getting more, but John talked me into it, and I'm like, yeah, sure, I'll take like 1,000 or two, whatever it was. And
dude, don't you follow Phil Gaffon and Tom Dwan on Twitter? Dude, they've said everyone's getting their Full Tilt money back, or they were guaranteeing $1 million. So I put a lot of weight into that, and I guess that was bad advice as well. So,
what are they doing with that? Are they backing that up, or?
I don't know. I haven't really heard. Yeah, I mean, I want a piece of that $1 million. So I have no idea. But I know Durr said guaranteed $1 million if Full Tilt doesn't pay anyone back. So, yeah, I'd like a piece of that $1 million.
Maybe
so,
it's
Durr,
like
if you're listening.
Maybe it's like an open-ended bet. You know, it's like, I bet you I'll make a hole in one before I die. I mean, actually, we should bet that, JK. Let's bet it for 1,000.
That Durr's going to pay out?
No, I just got, you know, it's like the golden rule in betting is that you just never make open-ended bets. Everything has to have a timeline, you know? I can bet you $1,000 that I'll make a hole in one playing golf, or I'll bowl a 300 series, or a 300 game in bowling.
In your lifetime, because you're on a free roll, right?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure that's not what Tom's intent was, but you know, you never know. Like, but that is the number one thing, and with any sort of bet or whenever there's money being exchanged, there has to be a timeline there.
Yeah, well, it's been over a year, so Tom, if you want to start thinking about paying out soon, just contact me. you know my email. I've already said it, so. All right, well, let's get to some strategic stuff. This is actually after a show about strategy. So we're going to focus on cash games mostly, but we do want to talk about some unique tournament situations from time to time, especially since Joe's considered a world-class poker player. Just don't ask Stealth Monk about that. He's got an ongoing online feud with some kid named Stealth Monk. I was actually watching the other night just some YouTube footage of the Epic League tournaments, and I was watching the first one, the one where Chino Rheem ended up winning, and it was the final table, five-handed. You want to talk about this hand, Joe?
Oh, yeah. This was an interesting hand we were talking about. It's kind of the big one. It was between Erik Seidel and Chino Rheem. The blinds were 15-30K, and they were five-handed, and Erik opened raised to 70K in the cutoff with 7-5 off. Chino called on the button, and everyone else folded. The flop came ace-ace king rainbow, and Erik bet 105 into about a 205 pot. So he bet half pot, and Chino called. The turn was an offsuit 7. Now Erik makes a pair of 7s. He bet 180 into 400. Chino raised to 405. Erik called, and then the river's an offsuit 4. And Erik checked. Chino bet all in for 729K into 1.2 million. And Eric's getting like almost 3-1, and he tank called. And Chino says good call and turns over queen 10 offsuit. Yeah, it was a really interesting hand. I think we should discuss it. I mean, not to knock you know, Erik's play. I mean, who are we to ever knock Erik Seidel? But not to, you know, because he's a world-class player, he has adapted to the times and how people are going to be bluffing a lot more. But let's talk about, like, what we think about Chino's line, you know, whether it's believable.
Well, actually, I wanted to ask you Erik's bet on the turn. Most people don't bet his hand on the turn. Do you agree with that? He turns third pair. So do you think people would continue betting when he actually makes a hand? Or what do you keep bluff? I mean, what do you make of his turn bet when he bets a seven? Is that like a bluff or a value bet? What's he doing?
I don't think there's anything wrong with it. You know, this is a spot like Chino's going to be calling with a lot of like mid pairs on the flop. That now on the turn, you could be beating, you might not be beating, but more likely he either has an ace or king or like a Broadway draw, or he was just floating with air and now he's probably going to fold to like the second barrel. I don't know how often Chino's going to be just floating with air there. I don't know what I would do like once I turn to seven. I certainly don't mind Erik's line of just betting very small. Hopefully you can end it there.
So I was saying it's like a merge bet where he's basically value betting, but also could be bluffing in some ways, trying to get off some eights, nines type of hands possibly.
Yeah.
So, okay. And then,
I'm sure Erik was thinking, okay, well, if he calls one more, then I'm just done with it. You know, with that, when he bets a seven on the turn.
Right. Okay. All right. Well, let's talk about Chino's line. What do you think?
I mean, you know, Chino's a tough player. Like, he's tough because he makes plays like, you know, he makes plays like this. He's always fighting it for every pot. Like, what do I think about his line? I mean, I'm going to pick better times to bluff. Like, you know, I usually don't try to bluff out a preflop raiser when the board comes ace-ace-king. Like, because they have a lot more... Yeah. They have a lot more hands than you do. You know what I mean?
So yeah, they're going to smash that board more than the caller is.
Yeah, for sure. So usually if the board comes ace-ace-king and, you know, if I don't have much, like, I'm probably just going to fold. Like, I give it up a lot to the preflop raiser. But, what do I think about Chino's line? I mean, looking at this hand, like, there's the raise on the turn really doesn't make much sense. At all, because like, what's he really raising on the turn? You know, like, other than ace king or maybe ace seven, like, if Chino just had like an average size ace, I think he's just gonna call again. I don't really see him raising like too often. I mean, maybe some people would raise there, but I don't know. I just don't see him raising too often with an ace in that spot. I mean,
yeah, I don't think he's raising either because I think they were the top two chip leaders with five players left. Why would they want to play a huge pot against each other? Why would Chino want to do that? Chino knows Erik is a world-class player. So why would he get involved in a big pot if he has just three aces there? But the other important aspect of this hand is that Erik knows this too. Erik knows the lines Chino's supposed to take with three aces in this spot. So I think Erik, and that's the reason why Erik ends up making the call, is that Chino would almost never raise here with three aces. He'd only raise here with four houses. And he might not even raise with four houses. He might Chino's in position, right?
Yeah, but I mean, I think he's raising with all full houses. But, you know, Erik bet the flop, he bet the turn. Like, there's a very good chance Erik has. You know, there's a decent chance that Erik has an ace. So I don't think, yeah, like, you know, like you said, there, it's a very narrow range of hands that Chino's are trying to represent by raising the turn there. And that's why, you know, Erik called and called the river. A good point about this hand to make is Erik's river call. I don't know how long he thought or whatever.
It was for a while. I'm sure they edited it, but even when he was just thinking, at least a good 2 minutes, it might have been longer. They always edit it when it's on air or whatever. So, I mean, and I was saying this to you before, too. From a technical standpoint, it's actually not a tough call, even though on air, in real life, whatever, it looks like an amazing call calling with third pair. But from a technical fundamental standpoint, Chino has a lot of air in his range given the line he takes. We were just discussing why he should never be raising with three aces on the turn here. So he almost never has three aces. The only hands he could have to raise is like ace king, pocket kings, and pocket sevens, maybe ace seven. And Erik has a seven, so he has a blocker to a seven. So he's Chino's less likely to have sevens or ace seven.
I don't think we should totally. We shouldn't totally. Negate any other hands. Like Chino, I think there's a good chance he's raising with ace queen, ace jack, trying to give value from other weaker hands for sure. We shouldn't say he's never doing it then.
Yeah. I mean, there's no absolutes in poker. I understand that. But most likely he's not raising. Even with ace jack, ace queen, I think he's more like, I've played with Chino. I don't want to say it's definite, but I can see him just calling the turn there and then waiting till the river to value raise or to call again. And that's how you should play a hand like three aces, just to call the flop, call the turn. You want to let the guy, if he's leading, you want to keep letting him bet, whether he has value hands or air. And Eric's aggressive enough that he might fire three barrels. And, I think the better line, I'm not saying based on Chino's game, that's what he should do. But I'm saying in general, from a good fundamental way of playing, is just to flat the turn and then either call the river or raise the river. And I think Erik knows this too. That's what I said. The big reason why Erik calls is that Chino, just when Chino raises a turn, he's just repping very little. And I think it helps that the flop is ace-ace-king, believe it or not, because Chino's less likely to have full houses. If the flop's like ace-ace-eight, I'm still not sure. Erik might still call, but then Erik can definitely think, well, there's more full houses in Chino's range versus an ace-ace-king flop, because he could have pocket eights, ace-eight, that he would he wouldn't normally re-raise pre-flop, whereas on an ace-ace-king flop, Chino probably 3-bets kings and sometimes 3-bets ace-king. I was talking to you just about this hand before the show, is that in real life, even though we explained from a fundamental point of view why it's not an impossible call, but in real life, it's really hard to execute and make this call, right? For all your chips, just in the heat of the moment.
Yeah.
I mean, you've been in it more often than me, where you faced a big bet and you played a lot more 10Ks.
One thing I want to mention about this hand is on the turn, when, if Chino were to have an ace on the turn, we would say that calling is a better play here. I mean, a lot of times people are going to raise there, they're going to take down the pot, and they're going to be happy. And they don't really think about, if I do call, now this guy may put a big bet out there, even if it's like half the time or 30% of the time, the guy's going to try to bluff the river because he knows you're just calling with, maybe you just have, king-jack or king-ten. You're just going to call a few times, but he's going to fold on the river. So if Chino were to have an ace here, people kind of might raise in that spot, which I wouldn't agree with. I think you're picking off a lot more bluffs by just calling again. You're getting value in the long run, even though people are sometimes scared because they don't want to face a big bet on the river. So they think it's better to raise the turn and just win it there. You know what I mean? I don't think it's all that uncommon.
Yeah, but that's definitely the wrong way to play a hand from a fundamental point of view. It should never be making a play just to try to end the hand. I actually went over a hand online in our forums where someone brought up the same point. The sky raised with trips because he wanted to end the hand there. And I'm like, no, you should never think that way. If you're raising with trips for value, you should never want the hand to end. You want to get called. So why would you want the hand to end if you have trips and you have the best hand? That's the amateur way of thinking. And, people are happy to win the pot. That's why you see people making it 100 at 2-5 no limit or 5-10 no limit. Because they just want to win the blinds.
This is what totally separates, someone who a totally amateur player versus people trying to become pro versus good pros and whatever, is that the amateur players, they really don't want to take the bad beat. You know what I mean? If they flop trips, they want to win it there. And I just think that's, the case with a lot of amateur players. If they flop a big hand or trips or whatever, they don't care. they just remember what it was like when the last time they got beat by a guy hitting his two outer or by a guy hitting his flush on the river. Like they just don't want to go through that feeling again. So they're not thinking, well, what's the best play here in the long run? What's going to pay off the most in the long run? And that's kind of the way you should be training your mind to think. I don't know. I mean, don't you see that? Like, a lot of amateur players, right? I mean, they're just...
I agree totally. Cash games and tournaments. You'll see someone make a big raise, and then he wins the pot, and it's like, I'm happy to win. He'll show, like, the
He'll
nuts.
He'll show us that, or, yeah.
You know, an almost unbeatable hand is like, I'm happy to win it. Like, I'm happy to win it here. And my thought is always, really? Like, if you played it, take a different line, you probably would have won more money, but okay. So, yeah, they make that comment all the time, I'm happy to win it here.
Yeah, so I suggest that to a lot of like players who are trying, you know, don't be so, if you do take a bad beat, just react as each card comes, you know, you don't want to just overplay a hand just because you think you've been losing that day or something like that.
Yeah, that's a good point. It's because we have like selective memory, remember all the bad times or whatever, things like that. That's why some people play garbage hands because they remember winning a huge pot with like four or five off, so next time they'll play it again. It's just selective memory that it just happened. But I mean, I stress this all the time, and all the good players know this. It's all about EV, what shows the most EV, and just follow that. Just take the high ground, you know, the EV roll to the high ground. That's it. But one last thing about this hand is, and you were mentioning this too, what would have been a better line for Chino to take? Did we say what he had? He had Queen 10 off, by the way.
Oh, so he had like Queen 10. He just floated the flop and then raised the turn. You know, in a spot like this, if you don't think Erik has anything, you have to think, okay, well, what's the most believable line for me to take? Yeah, it looks strong. Like if I raise the turn and now bet all in on the river, my hand looks very strong. But you don't really want to try to bluff Erik off an ace or a king. You just want to bluff him off
you can bluff him off a king.
I mean, you can maybe bluff him off.
You don't want to be bluffing him off three aces. You never try to bluff someone off trips. Come on.
No.
That's suicidal. So what do you suggest? Here's my point before you say something. Is if Chino's raising the turn here and then shoving the river, he's got to be thinking Erik's range is pretty wide, probably doesn't have a lot of aces in his range. If he really thinks he's trying to get Erik off an ace, that's just crazy. I mean,
yeah.
No one's going to fold three aces five-handed. So, but Chino must be thinking Erik's range is pretty wide, so he could have a king here, he could have, you know, some pocket pairs or whatever. If Chino thinks that, you know, much better line would have been just to call the turn and then bet the river when Erik checks. If he thinks there's a good chance Erik doesn't have much here. Because obviously that's what he thought.
Yeah, and even, you know, you can call again. You still have some equity. You know, maybe you can hit a jack or something. But you're not really calling for your equity. You're calling because you really don't think the guy has anything. So, you know, if you want to make your line believable with your hand... you know, let's say he had a hand like Jack 10 or something, like some sort of not even a good showdown hand at all. Like, I would just call again. And then when you bet on the river, you don't even have to bet very big. Like, Erik's going to know, okay, this guy called two bets. And now, even if Chino were to bet like 40% of the pot on the river, it's just an easy fold for Erik, even if he did pair up with his sevens on the turn. So I think it's, you know, just if you really thinks Erik's full of it, he should call again and then bluff small on the river. He doesn't have to bet very big. You're not trying to get Erik to fold three aces, so.
Yeah, I think that's a much more believable line of like three aces that Chino can have, or even a hand like King Queen that Chino could be value betting on the river. It makes way more sense, and Erik, since he's such a great player, would realize this as well. The thing about poker is like the leveling wars going on and just understanding what these top players think. So, and this is what Chino's mistake was. Chino should realize what level Erik's thinking at. And Erik knows if Chino took this line, calling the turn, value betting like 30, 40%, like Joe says, that looks much more believable for Chino to have some hands like three aces or king, queen. And Erik's probably going to fold a seven there. So that's a much better line, Chino.
And one last thing to mention, what Erik did in this hand. And we kind of stress this. Erik calls the raise on the turn. Now it would be very bad if Erik were to call the raise on the turn, and now the river is a total blank, like an offsuit four, and now Erik kind of talks himself out of his read on the turn. Like, he's calling the turn because, hey, what's this guy really raising me with on the turn? Like, Eric's thinking, you know, what's Chino really raising with? He's either got, like, a full house or he's probably bluffing. So, you know, a good point is that Erik didn't get talked out of, like, his river shove. You know, once he called the turn raise, he called the river shove when the board changed it. Didn't change at all.
Right. I think once he calls a turn, he almost always has to call the river if nothing
changes.
Yeah,
you do. He does have to. We tell that to people that we're coaching and things like that. It's like, once you call that turn bet, you should be calling the river, because the river didn't change anything. So a good call by Erik, you know, both on the turn and the river.
Yeah, I mean, no knocking him. It's definitely a really tough call. Again, like I said, in real life moments, it's very difficult playing for your tournament life. But it's always good to, like, I'm sure Erik did this. He thought about it, broke the hand down exactly like what we just discussed here and made the play. But sometimes in the heat of the moment, I mean, sometimes I break a hand down, and I'm sure you've done this too as well, Joe, in a tournament. I'm like, okay, this guy's range is mostly air, but I end up folding anyways. Yeah, I don't have the balls. I'm like, well, this guy's like 80% air, 20% value hands, better than mine. But heck, if I'm wrong, I'm out, so screw it. I'm just
gonna fold
like a girl.
Okay, I'll just lose.
No knock on girls out there. Yeah, so, I mean, you have to give him a lot of credit for actually going with his read and making that superhero call. It's tough to do in tournaments when it's basically for your tournament life. All right, let's get to a question one of our viewers, or actually one of our members, had by Stage Joe. He says, I really love playing tournaments because of my competitive nature. Really love to win it all. I think that's what attracts a lot of people to tournaments. It's just the end result, the finish line aspect of tournaments. Cash games are so different that you can very seldom win it I disagree with that line. You're going to win more frequently in cash games than tournaments, obviously. I realize I need to play cash if I'm ever going to be able to build my row. I agree with that, because there's just less variance. But I seem to have the worst luck, run bad, whatever you want to call it, in cash games. I either win small after many hours of play or lose big in a short amount of time. The big losses are always when I get in good and get sucked out on. And he gives an example where he had aces and lost to King 10. And then flopped a set against the bottom set, and the guy rivered or turned the one outer. I think he's just complaining about short-term variance, obviously, because that's not going to keep happening. You're not going to lose to one outers time after time. So he's being results-oriented short-term. But, I mean, we're all guilty of that, though. So
it's hard not to be. It's so hard not to be. I mean, it's so hard not to be, because you play poker for money. I mean, people are playing because they want to win money. It's hard not to be results-oriented in those spots.
If you want to win at poker, you can't be results-oriented. But the human nature within all of us, we're vulnerable to that. So and there's money involved. Whenever it comes to money, there's going to be emotions involved, you know? Remember that time? I mean, not to kind of derail
this,
or
your
whatever.
Set of fours, when,
man? Yeah, Mohegan Sun 4, the guy, the old guy. Remember, he made a...
Let me tell it. This is my... it's not my favorite, but I kind of felt bad. About this one. But we were in a 5-10 game together, John and I and a couple other players, and John gets involved in a big pot with a fish, and... one guy was like kind of a total fish. Another guy was whatever. The other guy was kind of a fish too because of the play he made. But the flop came ace 4-5 with two spades and one club, I think. And
ace 4-6. No, it was rainbow ace 4-6. I remember the hand. Trust me.
I thought it was ace six rainbow. No,
there wasn't a flush.
All right.
No, there wasn't. It was ace 4-6 rainbow. You don't remember the details.
Go ahead.
We're like 3,500 effective at 5-10, 350 bigs. And somehow we get it in three ways on the flop, and I have bottom set. And obviously I'm a little concerned, like, man, how am I good here against two guys getting in 3,500 in on 5-10? and turns a brick, rivers an eight, and I roll over my set of fours. And the guy, the preflop raiser, only has ace king off. He puts
no,
in 3K.
Like, no flush draw. I thought he had.
Yeah.
Yeah, nothing.
And so I thought I was going to win. The old guy, fish player, didn't say anything for like a few seconds on the river. And then you can go ahead and tell the rest of the story.
He just, well, it went like John checked, he checked, and now the preflop raiser bet like 125. John check raised to like 375, and the guy cold calls. And now the preflop raiser three bets with ace king. And now John, you know, JK shoves, and now the other guy calls off like he called off like $2,800, I think, or something a lot. Like the pot was over 10K. He called off like $2,800 with just, you know, an open ended, and it was a three way all in. The other guy called too with ace king for like 2K, and yeah, that was an amazing. So the guy rivers a straight on the river, and just stands up in the middle of the casino, wins like this 10K pot or whatever, and just starts like calling his friends over, and he's saying, "Bring in the back up the truck or whatever. I want to put these chips in there."
He was asking his friends, "Bring me some bags. Let me load all these chips into my bags." And he was saying he won the lottery. I mean, he was yelling off top of his lungs or whatever. The guy on my right actually said, "Man, I mean, whatever. I'm a pro, whatever. You're supposed to take these beats well." And I did. And the guy on my right's like, "Man, how can you handle this? Don't you want to like punch this guy out? Because, you know, he's celebrating." It went on for like 5 minutes. He just created a big scene. Everyone came over to the table in the poker room seeing what the fuss was about.
Yeah.
And the guy's like, "Man, I can't believe how you're handling this." And I'm like, "Well, you know, that's just poker, whatever." So. And that's the way you got to be. Like I said, we're just talking about being results-oriented. Yeah, I mean, I could be results-oriented and knock the guy out, just like being a total jackass and calling off 3K with an open-ender at 5-10, right?
Yeah.
So, but whatever, that's just, you know, you run bad sometimes. But anyway, going back to this guy's question, his question is, how do I weather the storm of such an amazing bad run to get to the other end of the spectrum? That's kind of a generalized question of like, how do you deal with bad beats and stuff and just, you know, until it turns around? So let's answer that when we bring on our guest, Jameson Singer. So right after this break, we'll bring on Jameson Singer, who is actually one of our original students, Joe and my original students. And we'll talk about the stress and just the everyday trials and tribulations of being a live cash game grinder. He used to be an online tournament player and made the transition. So we'll talk about that as well right after this break.
It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn bustos into robustos. Brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker. And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tehan.
Hey, so today we're here with Jameson Singer. Jameson, you want to give a quick intro about yourself?
All right, what's going on, guys? I can't believe I have to look at you now and talk to you at the same time. It's a little scary.
Yeah, the podcasts were so much better.
I know, right? I didn't have to look at JK and Joe's ugly mugs. But
did you get to have the courtesy to at least clean your bedroom a little? Is it clean? It looks like a bunch of stuff scattered on
it. Yeah, that's part of the aura, though, JK. I'm going to do the same thing next one. Dirty.
Look at your room, Joe. We'll just call that stuff behind.
No, this is a guest bedroom. It's not.
I gave it an online, back to like online MTT aura about it. So I wanted that feel, you know, the good old days. No, but my name's Jameson Singer. I was a MTT online grinder for about 3 years. And once Black Friday hit, I took to Vegas and I met you guys there, and that's where I became a featured student for you guys, and I've been making the transition from online to live ever since. And it's been definitely up and down, to say the least. Just trying not to go broke, continue working on my game, but it's been a pretty wild ride. And I definitely have owed a lot to you guys for helping me learn cash games. And
Jameson Jameson was like one of our first students, and John and I did quite a few sessions with him. And I thought they went really well. We discussed like a lot of points, and then like, you know, it's kind of funny when Jameson was like winning. He's like, "Oh man, you know, I'm like thinking about the things you told us," and it's like, you know, it's all so clear. And I'm like Jameson, well, you know, part of it's just good variance, and you know, part of it, maybe, you know, I mean, and then he'd go through a losing session and be like, "You guys suck." Like,
yep. Let's be honest. What happened at the World Series? You ran hot. Whatever, yeah, so, you're going to strip clubs all the time. With your, you thought poker was easy. This is a life. Yeah, are we allowed to get into that too much?
Yeah, I don't know. I actually just started a thread on 2+2 about just my whole story from last April until now. And actually, the Sapphire story is one of the big pieces of it that I just posted. But yeah, no, I started off in the first couple weeks. You can go on 2+2 and read it. You can go have a ball with that. I wrote it all out. It's there for everybody. I don't need
to. Okay, well, tell us now what happened in Sapphire. We gotta hear it.
All right. Basically, the first couple weeks of the World Series, I was doing really well, and I was
the shortened version.
Yeah, well, I was up like six. It's part of it, and I was up $6,000. And then this one night, I went to Sapphire with a bunch of people I had just met, and I end up like blowing through almost $1,000. But I met a stripper in the process and took her home and yada, yada, yada. That's pretty much the story. But, you know, obviously I go into more detail on the thread. So that's that. But after that, it was really funny because right after that happened, I started running so bad and variance just hit me, and I was still dealing with the learning curve for cash games. And it turned out to be almost like a break-even trip after I was up so much. So then after that, I came home.
Break-even in poker, or just break-even after?
I ended up making some money, but through, you know, drinking and going out and Sapphire, I ended up breaking even.
The Sapphire and Rhino packs are pretty expensive. Okay, I mean you're buying them $1,000 on. First, dude.
Yeah, I wasn't too happy about it. But,
you know, I guess that happens when you're running well. Again, we're talking about being results oriented. I mean, I tried to warn you. I did warn you at the time. Said why? We talked about your win rate at the time is astronomical, and I said don't expect us to continue. So just, you know, follow that advice. And okay, so yeah, Vegas was a good trip for you, obviously. So
I was thinking, wow, Jameson's really learning. Like, you know, right when he started doing well in the beginning, I'm like, wow, he's really learning, you know what I mean? And then he would, like, do other things, and it was just like, he was just all running good, yeah, for sure.
You thought you were the greatest teacher.
Why do I have a feeling the chatbox listeners want to hear more about strippers and nights out? But we're going to get into the strategic stuff now. So you had a good trip to Vegas, and then you come back to New York City where you reside, and you play in the underground clubs, is it?
Yeah.
Exactly. Where do you play? Okay.
You know, it's not like it's underground is kind of a, it's just kind of a really like shady way of looking at it. I mean, a lot of these places I play at are really nice apartments in Midtown. So it's not like some shady KGB.
Okay. The image I have is from Rounders when, you know, Matt Damon's character goes plays and you get buzzed in and it's all smoky and there's a lot of shady people. So it's not exactly like that.
No, not anymore. I'm sure there are a couple places like that, but not any that I've been to.
A lot of home games I've been to, it's kind of like that. I have to say, I don't play home games anymore, but I think the ones I've been to, it's pretty much like Rounders, I would say.
Well, I've tried to avoid. I've been really careful with what games I play at. So I went home, and one of my good friends, who I actually met out on the trip with you guys, Mike Wolf. We were grinding a lot there. We were grinding a lot in AC, but it turned out to be really stressful for me. I had kind of, it was almost like a quarter life crisis, and I just didn't even know if I wanted to do this anymore. I ended up quitting basically all the way through. I was just completely done with it. I ended up bar backing like a freaking 16-year-old down the street. I ended up bartending a little bit there. And then that was for 3 months. And then in January, I was fired, which was awesome, and I ended up picking poker back up again, and I've been grinding since then. Although I definitely can relate to the emailer that you guys were talking to, because I've been in a huge downswing right now, and it's been really tough because it's hard. You know, it's one thing to have enough of a bankroll where you don't really have to worry about a downswing, or even if you're in a big downswing, you can cope with it because you know you have enough to sustain. But the situation that I'm in right now is I really feel like I need to win just to pay the bills, to pay rent, and just to stay afloat. So it's been really hard for me. It's been a big struggle each session that I go through, where I just continue to run bad and nothing seems to change. So that's been one of the biggest parts for me. And I think one of the biggest parts of run bad that people don't realize is being card dead. And I went through a good couple weeks of that where I felt like I really wasn't getting any hands. And there are times when you try to force things because you sit there and you're like, wow, I'm really not playing one hand. And then, you know, I would record one and tell it to you guys, and you would say something like, just fold. And I'm like, but I'm already folding every other hand. So what the hell am I supposed to do? So that's been tough, but...
You know, that's funny. One of the other kids that we kind of work with, he was like, he always says, oh, it's James. And James always says, like, you know, I'll say something along the lines of, because he occasionally has like a fancy play syndrome, and I'll say something along the line of, oh, you know, well, I would tell him, I'm like, James, you know, the way you make money in poker, it's not from like making all these crazy plays. It's not from like, you know, yeah, the crazy plays like look cool and you can tell your friends about them, but the way you're really making money is getting the most value when you have the best hand. And he was just like, well, I just don't get dealt winning hands very often. Like, and I'm like, well, that's not an excuse. That's not an excuse for you. That's not an excuse for everyone, because everyone gets dealt the same amount of winners as losers. And I mean, it doesn't matter if you're Phil Ivey or anyone else. I mean, everyone gets dealt the same amount of winners and losers. It's just that's how you make money in poker, is just getting value off your big hands. And yeah. I guess, yeah, actually, if you're not making winners for a while, like, it's going to be tough for sure.
Yeah, and that was really tough for me to deal with too. And I've been trying to play a lower variance style now to try to you know, save money.
Go ahead, JK.
No, I was gonna say the way to make money in poker, yeah, is to get max value whenever you have it. But I think the key way is never to make mistakes. That's pretty much it. So, and if you're getting impatient, you start, you know, the Jack 10 off, the 4-5 suited start looking better and better, and you end up playing them, you're just making a mistake. You're just chasing bad money. So it's just try to not make mistakes. This kind of reiterates Joe's point, is you don't make money by outplaying other players. You make money by making fewer mistakes than other players. So, and it's tied in with just having patience, stuff like that. It seems like that's what you're talking about, Jameson, that you're getting impatient, you're not getting dealt big hands or whatever, but you just have to maintain the discipline. And like Joe said, everyone's going to get, over their lifetimes, everyone's going to get dealt the same ratio, the same percentage of certain hands all the time. It's just whoever makes the fewest mistakes is going to make the most money. So you just have to wait and stay patient.
And you show, and I think I've like said this to you a couple times, James, and it's like, even whether or not you win or lose a big pot, like, I'm always thinking about, how did I get the money in? And I think that's like a really important thing for like pretty much all poker players. Like, how did the money go in? Mm-hmm. It, you know, it's not like, oh yeah, this guy called my $10 raise pre-flop and it all went in on like a 7-deuce-deuce board for like $1,000 or something crazy. Like, yeah, the guy had a deuce or whatever. Like, the guy had a full house, you know, like, and then they'll be like, yeah, well, how did, you know, I can't believe he called me with 7-deuce preflop. Well, like, who cares if he's going to get 1,000? And, you know, I mean, it's like, how much ahead, how much behind? I mean, this
talking about that hand, I don't know, Jameson, if you heard Joe was brought up the hand I played at Mohegan Sun. I mean, when I got it in with set of fours, the reason why I didn't overreact, punch the guy, was I realized, hey, this guy's willing to put in 3 dimes with an open ender when I have a set. It, you know, even though I lost real money, but think about all the Sklansky bucks I just won, right?
So, yeah, but it's tough when you're struggling, though. I mean, it's tough when you're struggling. You need those. for sure.
Yeah, and two, it's not. It hasn't just been one of the toughest things. It hasn't just been the run bad technically with just the actual hands, but it's like, for example, you know, I was at Sands. I went to Sands with Mike a couple days ago, and this guy ended up putting in, you know, $400 pre with 9-7 versus my ace king, and he got there. And the most frustrating thing for me about that is that he essentially took that money and a half hour later just, you know, peaced out. He was just gone. So, and that's been happening a lot for me lately, is just I'll take a cooler, or maybe I'll even make a mistake and somebody will just be stacking my chips and then they'll just leave the table. So it's not even like I can try to win it back. It's not even have an opportunity to. And that's been really frustrating. And just, I don't know, all around bad luck. I was, you know, talking when I was down at Caesars for the circuit. I was talking to, I'd stepped away from the table to talk to Mike about something. And I agreed that I was just going to go pick up and we were going to leave. And I go there and I was like, and the dealer was dealing out the hands right as I got to the table. And I get dealt ace, king versus queens, and I end up losing. And it's like these things just keep piling up in my head until the point where you get that sort of mental game leak, where you're just like, oh my God, this is happening to me for some strange reason. Like, why do I deserve this stuff? And there's been a lot of thoughts like that I've been trying to deal with lately during this month and a half, 2 month downswing.
Yeah, I mean, that's what we're talking about now. It's just the everyday stress that comes with being a professional. Poker is unique in that, unique as a job in that it's like the one of only two jobs. Day trading is the only other one I can think of where you can go to work hard and come home with less money. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely something that you have to get used to, Jameson. And, you know, and we've shared this before. Joe and I have been playing for a long time. And believe me, I don't know how often Joe's gone through it, but I've gone through two or three extended stretches where nothing went right. 4 months. I remember 4 months. And I'm actually going through another one right now. So we're a long break-even stretch. But granted, a lot of other stuff has been going on in my life, so I haven't really played as much. But it happens, dude. It's just you just got to weather the storm. And the only thing you have to do, and I keep telling you this all the time, but and I'll keep telling you because easy to kind of stray away from this point, is all you do is focus playing your A-plus game. That's it, no matter how things are going. And one thing that kind of bothered me, what you said, was you're frustrated the guy left or whatever. Who cares? I mean, the guy took your money or whatever. You can't control that. You could only try to control things that you can actually control. If the guy wants to leave with your money, he sucked out on you, you know, you can't prevent him from leaving. So there's other fish in the pond, dude. So don't dwell on one guy. You're letting your emotions affect how you play and things like that. And I think you're also feeling like a sense of entitlement. And Joe's talked about this before. And I think Jared Tendler mentioned this in his book. Yeah, it's like the entitlement tilt, where you feel like, man, I'm like the best player on this table. How come I keep losing? These donks
are like, they're like, you get it in like that, and you're like, well, 80% of the time that money should be mine, like, you know what I mean, or 70% of the time that should be my money, and it sucks, like, and there's no real good way to get over that, I don't think. I mean, it's just you have to be able to deal with it. I don't know. I mean, I don't know, like, what good advice there is on, like, how to deal with that. There is none.
I want to ask you, Joe, it relates to Jameson. When you were starting out and you had a couple of bad nights, you know, when your bankroll was limited, now since you're robust now, it doesn't really as relevant. But, well, you know, when you're, I think you mentioned it, that you came to Vegas with $6,000. I'm only saying that because you mentioned it somewhere in public.
Yeah.
And early on, you must have had a couple of losing nights. You know, how did you deal with the stress like Jameson's going through right now?
Like early on, I mean, I could tell you about like when I went through some downswings, like, and I, you know, you really feel, you're like, well, geez, you know, what am I not doing right? And you're always questioning yourself. It's like the way now that I look at downswings is I literally sit there and I say, how did I get the money in? I mean, that's, you know, like, and I think that's the best way to look at, you know, when you're going through a tough time like that, it's like, how did I get my money in? How did I get my money in? And that's kind of like gives you the peace of mind, like, okay, well, I did this, I did that. And then if you make mistakes, so you can always just kind of like be studying about the game. And that way you don't really think so much about oh, well, how much did I lose? And it's like you're kind of studying, like, what can I do to get better, to win more, you know, to do better next time.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I know I kind of joke about this. We can joke about this, but it really comes down to, like, Sklansky dollars. If you're a millionaire in Sklansky bucks, which means you're getting in your money in good, then you don't have to be down on yourself. You know, eventually you're going to – that those Sklansky dollars are going to convert to real-life dollars. And mm-hmm. that's – as long as you're making the plays, you know, that'll lead you down that path. So and for people that don't know what Sklansky dollars are, it's basically just money made from – it's actually your equity whenever the money goes in translates to equity involved. So if you get an aces versus a naked flush draw, you're going to win 2 out of 3 times. So in theory, you're going to win 66% of the pot. And so that's how many Sklansky – so you'd win $66 out of every $100 in the pot, and you'd earn 66 Sklansky bucks. So basically that's it. If you know you're doing 1 Sklansky dollars, in the long run, it's going to – real money is going to even equal out to Sklansky dollars over an infinite number of hands. So
yeah, and
as long as you realize that, you know, you'll be okay.
What's been really good for me though is throughout my poker career, you know, there's obviously, you play poker long enough, you're going to deal with stresses and frustration all the time, and what I've really tried to do is just take that frustration, anger, and turn it into a positive. And for me, that was just, you know, studying more, getting coaching, just reviewing my hands. And I think if you just take that anger that you have, and instead of just feeling sorry for yourself or just dwelling on your bad beats, I think it's, you know, it's so much better if you can just let it out by either, you know, studying a lot more, or like I've been doing now, I've just been writing about it. And it's been really liberating for me to just go through my whole story over the last year, because it has been pretty miserable, you know, to say the least. And I've been through a lot, but to be able to get it out, or to be able to talk with you guys about certain hands or about how I'm feeling, you know, JK, I've called you a bunch of times when I've been down at Borgata, and I just felt like there was just nothing I can do. And being able to talk to you about it, it helped me calm down and be able to go back and play. So there's just a lot of those types of things. If you can just always try to turn into a positive, and obviously I don't do that all the time, but for the most part, I think I've been doing that, so that's definitely one of the ways to look at it.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, poker provides for a nice, like, a decent lifestyle when you're winning, but it's just like it's a lot of money, like, that's being exchanged hands, and it's never going to be easy. I mean, no one wants to, like, even the fish, they don't want to, like, give away money. They want, you know, like, you know, so it's never really going to be easy. So, I mean, you just kind of have to, like, remind yourself about that. Like, in times, like, it's going to be tough.
I mean, I know, like I said, when there's money involved, there's always going to be human emotions involved. That's just how it is. Wins and losses equate to that. But I always like to say one of the strongest traits I have that led to my long-term success is just not feeling emotions when I play. Like Joe's, just like that one hand when the guy celebrating, I was just pretty stoic and didn't say a word. And, you know, guys are saying, like, how can you stay like that? Whatever. It's just how I am. And that's, you know, if you can do, you know, just react like that, you'll be okay in the long term. And that's, you know,
what JK about pounded the table. I couldn't believe it. He almost pushed the table over. It's unbelievable.
Sure. I mean, there were some parts of me that wanted to, like,
FML, he just dumped a little bit of his drink out. That's JK's, yeah. That's JK's tilt.
Yeah. No, but all seriousness aside, I'm like, whatever. That's just, yeah. You just have to have a certain type of demeanor, and just, you can't let it affect you, Jameson. And I mean, I talk about this all the time. This is why I said, like, I love Jared Tendler, because he talks about something very important to it if you want to succeed in poker. It's just your mental attitude yeah. and approach to poker. And I say that's a big part of winning poker. And I always say, like, I'm not trying to endorse him just because of whatever reason. I actually believe in all of this, is that his book is one of the best poker books out there. It has nothing to do with strategy. It's all about how you approach the game from a mental aspect. And
yeah. He coached me for 2 years, and, you know, he did wonders for my game. But even then, I still went back. I've gone back recently to read the book, and it wasn't even, you know, I mean, he taught me a lot. But then going back and being able to read the book too, like, that was, it's great for, you know, anybody who's struggling. And I know that I mean, it doesn't, you know, it doesn't change your mindset overnight or anything, but it's definitely opens your eyes to a lot of things that you're going through and the emotions that you have and why you have them.
You know,
I think it's good.
Yeah, and when you go through like a good run, good stretch, you know, just remember that. Like when you're running bad, it's like, okay, I remember what it's like to run good, and it's like this is all a long run game. And hey, I still have money here. I still have money to play. I'm still like, you know, paying for things. Like, you know, just kind of remember that it's all a long run game. And like, how am I doing over the last month? How am I doing over the last, you know, few months, the last year, things like that. Try not to focus on the day-to-day, hand-to-hand reality of the game, you know?
Yeah, yeah, it's all about the long term. You just have to see everything.
As long as you don't go broke, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Well, I guess if you're going to go broke, then it's short term. But in reality, winning poker is all about the long term. Every decision you make, you got to view it in terms of long term, like an infinite number of samples, sizes. But anyway, what's this new blog that you have up?
Okay, well, it's on 2+2. It's under the poker the beats, brags, and variants section, and it's called a poker pro story after Black Friday to Sapphire and back. So that's the thread, and it's pretty good.
Definitely, that we'll look into about your nights out at Rhino and Sapphire, stuff like that.
It's definitely, but also the daily. It's a lot more than just Sapphire. It's about, you know, it's about everything that I've been through and what I'm still dealing with. So, yeah, that's that.
I know. Like I said, there's a lot of trials and tribulations, and the road is never easy. Even though poker seems glamorous on TV, but we know, Joe and I know the reality of it. There's a lot of ups and downs. And if you can do it the right way, more ups than downs. So, and it could be a rewarding life.
Yeah, so, and I plugged, thank you. I plugged Stack a minute too, so you're welcome.
Thanks for that, too.
James, we're going
to wrap it up. There's a couple of things, and you guys, Jameson, you can stick around. Thanks for the interview. So we're going to wrap up the show, but there's a couple of things, non-poker-related stuff I actually wanted Joe's opinion on. Since we're football fans, and Jameson, you live in New York City. Are you a football guy?
I am, yes, a huge football guy.
Okay, so what? So we're done with the poker strategy. I just wanted to get your quick thoughts on Tebow to the Jets. This is like the big news story, and you are in New York City. What do you think about that?
I personally think it's awesome because I don't really like the Jets or the Giants at all. So I'm a Redskins fan, and I suffer the most out of anybody. But
so you're saying Tebow is a bad fit?
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely. I mean, the only way it's not going to be a bad fit is if they win a lot of games, and I just don't really see that happening because Sanchez isn't very good.
You know what? I can't believe like there wasn't a team like Jacksonville or someone that didn't go after Tebow. Like he could have absolutely turned that entire franchise around for like what, like a third round pick or something. I don't even know what did Tebow go for. It was like 2 third rounders, or
it was like a fourth. I think it was like a fourth, two fourth
and a
rounders,
seventh,
or
fourth and a sixth.
He was supposed to seventh. Jackson.
He went for really cheap though, and it's like how could a team not like Jacksonville or someone just not go after him? I mean, it's Tim Tebow. He could turn everything around. I mean, Jacksonville sucks as it is. Like you might as well get a guy like Tebow to at least put people in the stands. I mean,
Jameson, if you don't realize, Joe loves Tebow. Joe had Tebow on his fantasy.
That's scary. Yeah, of course.
Well, he was good on my fantasy.
So, Jameson, obviously. Yeah, so. Again, selective memory if we remember the good stuff, not the bad
right,
stuff.
Right. If Joe's fantasy league was based around, like, completion percentage or, like, passing yards, I'm sure he would have second thoughts
about
Tebow.
Those don't count in fantasy. It's just about yardage and.
It's going to put people in the seats. It's going to make the team money. And like a team like Jacksonville or someone, they needed them. And
did you watch the press conference, though? It was like 200 reporters there for like a backup quarterback. And you want to tell me that's not going to be a problem?
The press conference was 30, 35 minutes. Jameson, take a number on how many times he said the word excited.
Oh, man, I heard bits of that. What was it, like 50 or something? Like something crazy?
45 times said 40, excited.
Yeah. Well, I heard him say Jesus Christ about 10 times, so.
Wow.
They asked him to talk about God and all this stuff, so he said that a lot, too.
Yeah.
Not really. I heard he kind of went away from that.
But I mean, Joe and I both. I think he's a good poker, or I think he's a good football player. Like, the guy just got it. I mean, he just knows how to do it. He just knows how to do it. Like, I think he's better than Sanchez personally.
I think you could throw a football better than Tebow can.
I mean, I could probably throw better, but I'm not a better NFL quarterback. That's for damn sure.
You might be. You never know.
Actually, no, I can't throw better. I totally take that statement away.
just wait.
Let me retract that one.
Yeah, just wait for like the first game that Sanchez just completely bombs and he throws like four picks, and New York City just blows up because they're just calling for Tebow. It's gonna be hell over there. It's gonna be great.
No, I love Tebow. I'm hoping he succeeds. How can you hate him? You might hate him as like a passing quarterback, but other than that, you can't hate him as a person.
No, I don't hate him as a person.
All right, well, let's wrap up the show. I saw a couple of good movies before we leave. Hunger Games, 21 Jump Street. You guys watch any of those two?
Not yet.
I saw Hunger Games like 2 nights ago. Awesome.
There's so much time, really.
Maybe not awesome. I thought it was good, but not awesome.
We'll just wrap it up. Hunger Game was, I would give it a B-. All this hype about it, whatever, blah. And 21 Jump Street was funny. I would definitely endorse that. And I used to watch the show, but it had nothing to do with the show. So, all right. I guess we're running a little over, so we'll wrap it up. And
all right.
So, thanks for Jameson coming on again.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Hopefully, things will turn around for you. That's just poker. And
I hope I see you in Vegas. Hope I make it.
Yeah. All right. Try to avoid sapphires this time around. Focus on poker.
No promises.
I know that's easier said than done. But all right. Again, for those listeners out there, use promo code QuadJacks82 at StackEmCoaching.com. And hope you guys enjoy the show. And we'll see you guys next time.
Yeah. And email us your questions. Any poker questions. We're open to email them all.
Yeah. We'll answer them all. Oh, one last thing. If anybody sees Joe or me around any of the card rooms, come up and say hi, and we're pretty friendly and approachable.
Yeah, for Jameson, sure.
Just touch the Joe's email head, just rub his head.
The email
he likes that.
John, J-O-H. Yeah, you can rub Joe's head for good luck. He never loses anymore. So the email is John, J-O-H-N, at StackEmCoaching.com, StackEmCoaching.com, John@StackEmCoaching.com. For John Kim and Joe Tehan, this is Cash Plays at QuadJacks, brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Signing off.
It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn bustos into robustos. Brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker.